Now turning our attention to this story in Tampa, where police are still looking for the person who shot and killed a rapper and hurt three others outside of a hotel there. Three others were injured in that shooting, as we said, but 26-year-old Charles Jones, who's also known as Julio Fulio, was reportedly there to celebrate his birthday. I think he was turning, 26 or 27. Police are still trying to figure out a motive for the shooting, but in some of his songs, he made jokes about the murders of people and other groups, as well as rappers.
I heard probably two series of shots, maybe like five shots each. And then probably like 5 minutes later, just heard some voices.
At that hotel, because according to social media posts, his pool party at an Airbnb.
What's up, YouTube? I'm Cara Janelle. Welcome to this video. As you see by the title, it's called The Death of Fulio, The Spiritual Context. If you don't know, Fulio was a rapper from Jacksonville, Florida. He was recently shot and killed on June 23rd in Tampa, Florida. And this young man was only 26 years old, had just turned 26. And the reason that I'm making this video is because I want to get into the spiritual context behind a lot of these celebrity deaths. And specifically the spiritual context or the spiritual laws regarding certain things as far as the power of the tongue, as far as death, and as far as all these things. So that's what we're going to get into in this video. But first and foremost, I just want to start by saying I pray this young man rests in peace. I pray that before he actually passed away, he had a chance to repent and get right with God. I'm not sure of the whole situation. I don't know if information came out about exactly when and how he died. We know he got shot, but I'm not sure if like he died at the hospital, died on the scene, if he died instantly, or what the case was. But I'm just hoping and praying that he had a chance to get right with God before he met his untimely death. But nevertheless, we're going to get into the video.
In regards to your music, in the event you pass away.
I got songs on songs on songs on songs on videos, like. So I'm going to be straight. I got drops. Like, they going to, like, my team going to make sure I'm, like, you feel me? I'm going to be set.
Is that something that's been talked about?
Nah, hell no. Oh. Yeah, nah, it ain't that.
But in the event you do pass and there's unreleased music, you don't mind that being released?
No.
When it comes to the spiritual context of things, we must first know and understand that the Bible is spiritual law that operates in every realm for believers and unbelievers and those who don't know it. Matthew 5, verses 44 through 45, these scriptures just remind us that God causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and he sendeth rain on the just and the unjust, reminding us that he is in complete control. In this passage of scripture, it even gives us ways to respond to those that are against us. These are spiritual laws, orchestrating our lives because it's a literal word of God. The Bible tells us that everything is upheld by the word of his power. Literally, we know in the book of Genesis that he spoke what he wanted to be created, and it was. In Luke chapter 8, verse 11, out of the Amplified Bible, it says, "Now the meaning of the parable is this, the seed is the word of God." The reason I'm bringing up this scripture is because in this passage of scripture, it talks about the seed being the word of God and bearing fruit of the manifestation of the promises of God, if you go and read this whole thing. But basically, it talks about how these seeds are planted and they go through a process and what happens. But the thing is, not only can we receive a seed of the word of God? A seed would be an example. You know, the Bible tells us that by his stripes we're healed. That seed, that word of God, is something that we receive and we put our faith behind it, and it brings forth the manifestation of what God has already promised, what his word has already told us will be. But the enemy can plant seeds also. And we know this because in Matthew chapter 13, it tells us about how the wheat and the tares passage or parable, how the enemy sowed these tares while men were sleeping. So just as you can receive a seed of the word of God, the goodness of God, of his promises, you can also receive a seed of the enemy. And the seeds of the enemy will always be things objective to the word of God. If the enemy comes with a seed about death or the spirit of death, you know, the Bible tells us that we shall live and not die to declare the works of the Lord. That would be the objection. That would be what the word of God says. That would be a seed of the word of God. But when the enemy plants seeds, he plants things that are an objection to what the Bible says. The Bible also tells us in Proverbs 18:21, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Now, love in the dictionary is described as an intense feeling of deep affection, a great interest or pleasure in something. So, it's definitely possible to love something negative. It's definitely possible to love things that aren't necessarily beneficial to a person. So when the Bible is telling us that death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof, meaning you're going to receive that fruit. You're going to eat that fruit thereof. So if there's someone that is constantly speaking out of their mouth death, or speaking out of their mouth life, the power in your tongue is going to bring about the fruit of what it is that you've spoken. And we're going to get deeper into, of course, death and life being in the power of the tongue further on into this video. Okay, so Fulio, as I mentioned, he was a rapper from Jacksonville, Florida. He rose as an artist in the past recent years, receiving a lot of attention with diss songs that he would make against other Florida artists, specifically Young and Ace, with his rebuttal to a song called Who I Smoke. And in Fulio's return, he made a cover to Fantasia's When I See You song. He does have quite a few reckless lyrics and actions, even in his music videos, rapping at the graveyard of these dead friends or enemies that he had. And he also spoke of his grandmother being into voodoo and even admitting that he participated in voodoo sacrificing of animals. I'm bringing this up not to judge his character, but to reveal the clear covenants that were forged and the spiritual laws that were objected. What I will say is, from the lyrics that I read of his, he seemed to be a really hurt individual, someone who faced a lot of trauma at a young age and throughout his entire life. He was very young when he died. He was only 26, and that's young in my mind. And to most people, that's still very young. But nevertheless, you know, he talked about how he lost his dad at a young age. I believe he said it when he was 12 or 13. And around that same time frame, lost his grandmother. He also talked about how, you know, one of his first friends that died in ninth grade of high school. He was in ninth grade when his friend died. So just from reading his lyrics, which I'm going to get into a few of his song lyrics, he seemed very hurt, like someone who faced a lot of things, probably faced a lot of trauma. And like I mentioned, some of the things he went through at a young age, and he probably didn't know how to process it correctly. One of the things that I feel a lot of people are facing, especially in you know, this generation with the music and the things that's out, because it's not just Fulio who raps about his hurt and his pain, but many of the artists that are out. And Fulio, I wouldn't really consider him mainstream. He was known to people who listen to that kind of music, or if you're from Florida, which I'm from Florida, I'm from South Florida, born and raised. And by the time, like, he really... But by the time I heard of who Fulio was, I was already living in Georgia by that time. But he's someone that's known. He's someone that we would consider famous. He's someone that had a drawing, had an influence. And, you know, there's some of his competitors and people that he was going up against that may have like a higher influence to other people, you know, out here. But he was definitely somebody in the music industry. And what I have noticed, like, as though I don't really listen to this, well, I don't listen to this music, like, at all. If I do listen to it, it's really to do research or because someone else is playing it or whatever the case is. But this type of music, when I hear these rappers rapping about it, they're always coming from a place of, like, trauma and hurt. And when you lose people when you're young, you don't always know how to process it. In the medical field, they talk about, you know, the five stages of grief and all these things that you go through. But when you're at a young age, you may not have an outlet to express those emotions, or you're around people that are basically telling you, you know, bottle it up, or, you know, get over it, or you just don't deal with it at all because you're at a young age. So you don't want to put that, those incidents or those traumas in the front of your mind. You push it down and suppress it. And I'm only speaking this because of situations that I've been through in my life. And I'm not talking about people getting killed necessarily, but like people dying and things like that. When I was at a younger age, like a teenager, and we hear this so often in music, even the most mainstream rappers or drill rappers or whatever, they often talk about their pain in their music. They often talk about, you know, how hurt they feel. And it may not be coming across in the sense of like they're being sensitive or they are, you know, expressing all their emotions and their feelings, because it comes across in an aggressive way. It comes across in like them trying to mask it, but at the same time speaking, you know, what they really are feeling. And from some of the lyrics that I read of his, this person was truly hurt. And as we get into the video and I get deeper into the spiritual context of things, I don't want anyone to think like I'm putting down on this person or coming against them because of the things that they said in their music or their behaviors or what they spoke as far as what they believed and things like that, because I'm not at all whatsoever. It's never a happy day or a happy video when a young black man dies. And that's period over here. But we're going to get into it. And one of the first things I want to get into is a song that he had called Sacrifices. So I'm going to read a few of the lyrics from Fulio's song called Sacrifices. The reason I'm bringing up these lyrics is because I'm going to just point out a few spiritual laws after the fact. And also because from the lyrics, you can hear that this person was hurt. You can hear that this person not only wanted to love, but also was kind of afraid to love based off of, you know, a lot of the situations that he went through, I'm assuming. And, you know, I understand that. I understand being afraid to love when, you know, people are dying or people are hurt you or whatever the case is. But let me just start at the beginning. I'm probably just going to read the first verse and the chorus. It says, I never judged you by your past. You took my love for granted. I never knew I could love. You made a thug romantic. I gave you vital information. You used that against me. You put it on the internet and showed the world our business. I'm antisocial with my love. Got me scared of venting. They killed little Jug in front of my face. And it put a demon in me. Your name tatted on my face like why they killed little Bibby. When you leave, then lock the door. You know that's your decision. I talk to God, feel like I'm stuck. Is I gonna ever make it? The wrong choices is why I landed in the situation. I'm scared to vent with my pistol. There's no conversation. I'm sorry. I couldn't find the lyrics online, so I had to write it out. And I wasn't sure if he was saying, with my pistol, there's no conversation, or with my pencil, there's no conversation. Then he said, I'm in Miami with my Zoes, and I just left little Haiti. You want to win inside the game, then make some sacrifices. You got to listen before you talk. Make sure you keep it silent. He said he loved me. Then he cut me. Thought that was my rider. It's red rum murder. I'm a crucifier. Then the chorus is pretty much, you want to win inside the game, then you got to take chances, you got to make sacrifices. And it says, I was just piped down in a box. Ain't nobody send no letter. Ain't nobody write me. Them M words said they love me, but they ain't put nothing on my commissary. I promise I won't show no love. Even on the 14th of February. And then other, I'm not going to go on in the song because the rest of the lyrics, you could, if you really want to go listen to it, you can go listen to the song. I'm not advertising to go listen to it, but if you choose to, that is your choice. But other notable things he said in it, he said, "You want to join the mafia, go catch a body." And then he said, "I got voodoo on my body, I can't run out of luck." And those things stood out to me, which is why I kind of pulled them into, you know, the lyrics of the song, because those were further on in the song, although I didn't read all of it. Anyway, I don't want to start rambling. I really want to get into a few of the things that he said. You can hear the hurt and you can hear the pain. He's saying, like, "I never knew I could love." You know, he talks about how he's scared to vent. He's scared to show his emotions and things like that. And that ties into what I was saying in the beginning of the video. You know, when you go through so much trauma so young, it can make you afraid to love. And it can make you, you know, kind of hesitant of showing love when people you get close to end up dead or end up hurting you or whatever the case is. But a lot of things that I want to point out also include the line that he said, "They killed little Jug in front of my face. It put a demon in me." That I thought was really something to, you know, point out. And then, most importantly, the chorus where it's saying, like, "You want to win in this game, you got to make some sacrifices." So, before I really get a little bit deeper into the spiritual context, Fulio supposedly, you know, was putting out his location of where he was going on his, like, birthday weekend celebration, and putting out, you know, "I'm having a party here at this Airbnb. Come through if you want the address. You know, message me and I'll send you the address." And then after that party got shut down, he, you know, said he was going to the club and was also inviting people to come to the club with them. And thinking of someone who is, you know, or did rap a lot about the opposition that he faced from people and his enemies being after him, and who also rapped about, you know, things that he might have done in the streets, it's kind of weird for someone to put out so much information about where they're at and where they're going to be. Also, something that he rapped about often was these other, I'm trying to use the right words because I don't want to come across like I'm, you know, like trying to condemn these people. And of course, I'm not saying any of this is correct or the right behavior, because it isn't, but I don't want to come across like that. But he rapped about, you know, other enemies that he killed, and it was a lot talking about a specific day, which was the 23rd of some month of some year that these people were killed. And he died on the 23rd. So I thought that was also interesting also. I just felt like the whole thing was weird when you're someone, most people don't really want people to know their location. I don't ever want people to know my location unless I know you personally. Nevertheless, someone who has a lot of enemies or has people after them, it's kind of weird for them to constantly be putting out their location during going to these places or while they're at these places. I found that strange. And when I went and started trying to research his music and his lyrics and things of that nature, I often find that these people who pass away untimely, a lot of their music alludes to like impending death, impending like they might die, impending like they're expecting to die, impending like, you know, somebody might run up on them. They all have these type of songs indicating like that's a possibility for their life. And if we go back to the scripture I brought up in Luke chapter 8 verse 11, talking about the seed being the word of God, and how I was explaining that, you know, the enemy can plant seeds also, and the enemy can plant, you know, a seed of death or a spirit of death, where these people come into agreement with the idea of death, come into agreement with untimely death. And without these things being objected, without these people praying or rebuking or rejecting, you know, that thought or those ideas or even those actions by other people, you know, Fulio had been shot or grazed previously in some other incident. So it wasn't like this was an unlikely thing to him, and he rapped about these type of issues. So when we go back to Death and Life Are in the Power of the Tongue, and They That Love It Show You the Fruit Thereof, the things that we're speaking is like what we're bound to, because the Bible is letting us know, they that love it show you the fruit thereof. What you put your words, what you're putting behind your words, your faith behind what you say, your belief behind what you're saying, you're going to eat the fruit of that. And I'm bringing this up because in the Bible specifically, I'm going to bring up two stories about when people said things and these things, you know, these things became them. These things, they ate that fruit. So the first one I'm going to bring up is Lot and the comment that he made when the angels were telling him to leave Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, this is located in Genesis chapter 19, and I do suggest you guys go read it because I'm not going to read the whole story. You guys should go read it and edify yourself in the Word of God. Nevertheless, the whole scenario was basically these angels went down to Sodom and Gomorrah to get Lot out because Abraham was interceding for Lot and letting, you know, petitioning with God, like, you know, I know you're going to destroy this place, but, you know, will you save him? Will you save somebody that's righteous? There was this whole petition, which you can go read about that in the Bible. Nevertheless, God sent these angels down there to go tell Lot, you know, you and your family get out of here because this place is about to be destroyed. To which they started leaving. And also something notable in that story is when his wife looked back, the angels told them, don't look back. You know, just go flee to the mountains, whatever, get out of here and don't even look back on this place. And his wife looked back and she turned into a pillar of salt. I'm sure, you know, even if you haven't heard this whole story, you've probably heard about that situation. If you're a believer or if you're not a believer, that comes across this video. Nevertheless, Lot made this specific comment. And he said in Genesis chapter 19, verse 19, behold, now thy servant hath found grace in thy sight, and thou hast magnified thy mercy, which thou hast showed unto me in saving my life. And I cannot escape to the mountain, lest some evil take me and I die. Now, the reason I'm bringing this up is because when Lot did make it to the mountain, you know, and they knew that Sodom and Gomorrah was being destroyed, his daughters kind of got him drunk. Both of his biological daughters, like they were his daughters, got him drunk, and he slept with both of them and impregnated both of his own daughters. And so after Lot did that, although he didn't physically die, he talked about some evil taking him and saying he would die. But anyway, he slept with his daughters, and especially as we're talking about spiritual laws in the Old Testament, there are spiritual laws all throughout the Bible. I don't want to get that misconstrued, but there's all these lists in Leviticus and in Deuteronomy. And in Deuteronomy chapter 27, verse 22, it says, cursed be he that lieth with his sister, the daughter of his father, or the daughter of his mother, and all the people shall say amen. And there's other scriptures that says, you know, the nakedness of thy father or the nakedness of thy mother, thou shalt not uncover. She is thy mother. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. This is Leviticus chapter 18, verse 7. And anyway, I'm bringing that up because there was all these spiritual laws and there were all these blessings and curses that God had laid out, you know, further into the Bible. And these actions were objection to, you know, what was right. And when Lot did that, it kind of, an evil did take him. An evil did take him in order for him to participate in these things. And although he didn't physically die right then, best believe there was some type of recompense for that action. And I want to bring up another story about Rachel. Now, Rachel was a lady in the Bible, and there was always these issues between her and her sister. And it was Jacob who ended up getting tricked into marrying. He wanted to marry Rachel, and Jacob was a trickster. That was his name. That's what his name meant. And, you know, God ended up changing his name. It's a long story. You guys should go read it. But then You know, not only is it one thing about the power of the tongue, but then there's another thing about what people are calling you. What is your name? And they said, like, his name meant trickster. So eventually, you know, he ended up getting tricked, where Laban, who was Rachel's and Leah's father, tricked him into marrying Leah because Leah was older. I guess she didn't look as good. Whatever the case was, he was trying to, like, get this daughter off of his hands. He tricked him into marrying Leah. And then, you know, Jacob was like, well, I really want to marry Rachel. And he was like, I'll work for her. I'll work 7 more years for her. And he ended up doing just that. But anyway, as the 12 tribes of Israel come about, they come about from this seed where he ended up having all these sons. And Leah was the one that was able to birth these kids. And Rachel was barren at the time. She couldn't have these kids. Anyway, she ended up having a child. But then she also ended up having another child who was going to be named Benoni, which had a negative condemnation to it too, a negative meaning in the name. And his father ended up changing the name. But anyway, I'm bringing that up. I know this is getting long-winded, but I'm bringing that up because she specifically made this comment where she said, you know, give me children, lest I die. This is what she said to her husband because she was barren at the time. So she did have one son, and then she ended up having another, but she died during childbirth of Benjamin. She died during childbirth. And as far as, you know, what I've researched and what I've, you know, kind of learned throughout the Bible, that was the only, like, prominent female in the Bible who died in childbirth. But remember, she made this comment, give me kids, lest I die. And she died. So when we talk about death and life being in the power of the tongue, and then these things that people speak, if they're not objected, they're not repented for, they're not condemned. When the Bible tells us, you know, cast down every high thought that exalts itself above the knowledge of God. When the knowledge of God is telling us one thing and the enemy plants these seeds of something else. If we're not objecting it and casting it down with the word of God, these things can come to pass. And they will come to pass without objection. And I'm bringing this up because the power of the tongue is a very heavy thing, very important thing, something that we all need to take heed to. And the last story I want to bring up before I end this video is about Cain. I was talking about in the last video I made, I think one of the last videos I made, about how Cain killed Abel. After Cain killed Abel, it said that the blood was crying out. The blood was of Abel was crying out all the way up. The father knew that he killed his brother, and the blood was literally crying out. That's what the Bible tells us. Go read the story. But nevertheless, you'll see some scriptures on the screen also. But nevertheless, you know, his judgment for killing his brother, God put this mark on him and basically was telling him, you know, like, wherever you go, people are going to know, like, I'm putting this mark on you. But And this marking was a marking because God had laid out this judgment for Cain, and Cain was saying, like, no, this judgment's too heavy. Like, wherever I go, they might just kill me because you have, you know, I did what I did, but you judge me in this way. And God said he was going to put this marking on Cain so that nobody would kill him, or they would, like, receive, you know, judgment sevenfold. But nevertheless, it was still this marking. Mind you, I don't believe it was a physical mark. It was like a spiritual marking. So, when we think about that story of how Cain killed Abel and the very blood was crying out, the Bible tells us that the life is in the blood. So, when people do bloodshed, this is why people sacrifice animals and stuff when they're into that demonic, you know, occultish witchcraft things. They pour blood out in order to offer it as sacrifice, in order to conjure up these demonic spirits and things like that. But when people shed blood, meaning they go kill somebody or something, the blood literally cries out, like we know in the story with Cain and Abel. But when you think about rappers who are promoting, you know, or speaking of people that they may or may not have murdered, or may have or may not have participated in being murdered. You know, when they say these things, if these things are true, if these people really, you know, were out there shedding blood, just how God marked Cain, you know, what makes you think these people aren't marked for what it is that they did? And if you're marked in a way like that, people who can see into the spirit realm, like, I'm not saying this in a positive way. I'm talking about people who look into it negatively. They can see these type of things that people have done, like evils that are attached to them and spirits and things that might be attached to them. So if God marked Cain for killing Abel, what makes you think that people who are killing people now in this present day aren't somehow marked for what it is that they've done? When we know how the Bible talks and lets us know judgments for certain things, and it lets us know how to respond to certain things, what makes you think that, you know, people aren't marked? Even David, being a man after God's own heart, he wasn't allotted to build the temple of the Lord because he had shed too much blood. And although he was fighting, you know, for the kingdom of the Lord, he wasn't pure enough to do that. And I don't want to make it sound negative, and I know I sound like I'm rambling, but I'm trying to get to my point here. My point is, you know, if people are marked in that sense because they already shed blood, and how Fulio spoke in his song, you know, if you want to make it in this game, you got to take chances, you got to make sacrifices. When people are already doing this, when people are already out shedding blood, allegedly, or what they tell us they're doing, when they're already supposedly doing this, there's already this type of evil that's falling, like following them. There's already these type of demonic spirits that they have come in agreement, whether they know it or not, they have come into agreement with it by the actions that they have done. I spoke about this in a past video, talking about people like NBA Youngboy, when they rap about people that they've supposedly gunned down or killed or things like that. When it comes to things like that, you don't necessarily... I talk also in other videos about, like, people forging, you know, these covenants in the entertainment industry, like forging covenants and making sacrifices after the fact or in order to get famous. But people who are already living this life where they're killing people, that bloodshed, that sacrifice has already been given based off their actions. And then they start rising in the industry because the evil that they have already done, these evil spirits that are attached to them, they have like this evil anointing that's promoting them in that industry because the industry itself is evil. So when we think about it in that sense, that these people can already be marked because of actions that they've done, and then they start rising in the industry, and, you know, in order to write songs, write music, some people smoke, some people drink, some people do lean or whatever it is that people are doing nowadays, and Molly and Percocet or whatever, they're doing all these things, and they're opening up their mind to another realm in order to write this music. And although it's their words, it's like they're tapping in to what the enemy wants them to say. They're tapping in to what these entities that are already following them based off their action or based off the doors that they open, they're tapping into that. And then people are singing these words, coming into agreement also by singing what it is that they have spoken. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. That's what the Bible tells us. And the Bible also tells us that if we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart in the Lord Jesus, then we're saved. So if just a confession and belief behind it gets us saved to spend eternity with the Father, you know, what does it really represent when we sing these songs that are like induced by demonic spirits, and we put our belief in, and we sing our heart out to these songs, and we put our belief in the words that these people are saying? Because people relate to trauma. People relate to hurt and pain because everyone's experienced it. So then when people make these songs in the industry, and it's got a nice beat to it, and the lyrics flow and everything, and people are singing this, they're putting their belief and their faith behind it. They're coming into agreement with the music. Secondarily, coming into agreement with demonic spirits that induce this person to write these songs. So I feel like I think I just want to leave this video off in a question. Since the Bible tells us the death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof, then what is it that you're speaking? Until next time, I'm Carl Janelle.